Hello. So today we are here to share our experience with developing a cross-platform app. During the almost 2 years ago we started, and we actually used JavaScript to make it. That's why it's related to GreeceJS. And because it's been a long ride with a lot of things to consider during its development, we thought it would be valuable for people to know what we went through, how our journey was, and where did we land at the end. So a few words about us. We're here from a startup called Covve. Covve is making an address book, a professional address book, with features like improving the data of your contacts, fetching data from the internet and adding it to your contacts so you have more information about your contacts. Things like personal CRM, where you can put notes and reminders after each call that you make with your phone. Other things like tools and utilities that aid the business relations, like sending business cards, exchanging business cards with other people through the app, and updating your profile. So all your contacts have your most recent information. And other things like keeping in touch with colleagues that you work with or you want to keep a warm relationship for a sale or something like that. Of course, we our target group is business professionals, so developers, it's not our direct target group. But I think everyone can appreciate what the app can do for them in their professional life. And finally, we have a network aspect to the whole project, where you can share business leads with colleagues that you trust, and from that, close business deals and things like that. So a few words about me and my colleague that we're going to be speaking to you today. I'm Michael. I've been professional software engineer for about 15 years or so. And my background is mostly C Sharp. So I was a C Sharp developer for quite a few years, over 10. And then about 4 or 5 years ago, I switched to JavaScript, initially with AngularJS. And I've been on it since then, using other technologies like Node.js for backend and things like that. And my colleague, Valadis. Valadis is also coming from a C# background. He was actually, a couple of years ago, he was still in working in Covve's backend using C# and .NET. And he migrated towards the cross-platform app when we started creating it. So okay, a few words about what is a cross-platform application and why do we care? So a cross-platform application is designed to reuse parts of the same code base to across different platforms. The promise is that you write your business and probably your UI once, and then you and it runs in at least two or more platforms, and as if it was written specifically for that platform. In our case, Android and iOS. So if we consider how Docker has changed the environment for backend development, where it gives you the promise that you write code once and it runs everywhere, I think we can all understand how valuable this can be and how promising it can be to our development. In the past, there have been many attempts to deliver this holy grail of app development to the masses. Some were less successful than others. But nowadays, the field is a bit clearer. Large players with complete and proven solutions are taking the world by storm. So big players currently are React Native. With the rise of React Web Apps, React Native is among the strongest cross-platform technologies currently. NativeScript is the closest you can get to React Native's paradigm while using Angular instead of React. Cordova is one of the first and strongest players in the field. And Xamarin is Microsoft's answer to the problem of multiple code bases. And Ionic, that you see over there, that we're going to be speaking about it today. Ionic started out as a bootstrap for mobile applications, but quickly turned into an alternative offering comparable to the rest. And finally, Unity is the go-to solution for multi-platform game development. I'm sure you all all seen their logo while playing your games in your mobile phones. But that's a totally different subject than what we're going to be speaking today. Each one has its strengths and weaknesses. Keep in mind that they are all technologies that are changing very fast. And what holds true today wasn't so a few months ago or a few years ago. And it's probably not going to be the same in the future either. So let's see some things about the what perception we when we decided and started implementing this project. What perception we received from the people. So cross-platform apps have been getting a bad rep for quite a while. I usually get replies from people when I'm telling them that I work on a cross-platform app. I'm sure that quite a lot of you, when you heard about the cross-platform application, were like, not these guys again, and things like that. Today I wanted to say if things are really that bad as people think in that area. And here I have a list of things that such technologies promise, and I want to make clear that this applies more to web-related cross-platform technologies and not things like Unity. Unity is a totally different paradigm, and I'm not going to be covering that today. So it's a whole different thing. But on the plus side, the promise is that you will be developing faster in a single code base, using the same people for multiple platforms, sometimes even for your web app as well, your website, leading to lower cost of development and easier talent sourcing. And on top of that, you also get a chance to jump on the latest tech train, as JavaScript is evolving really fast and web standards are changing all the time. And use a more established and familiar workflow from things like React or Angular that have been around for a few years now, and they have established a workflow that's common to web developers. On the other side, people are skeptic of using JavaScript in slower devices. I've heard countless times that, oh, it's not going to be fast enough, it's single-threaded, things like that. There's always the point that it's not as mature as native. Native has been around for quite a few years. Cross-platform development is kind of a new thing. It's about 5 years old or something like that in total. People are worried that they're going to have slower performance no matter what they do. It's like an out-of-the-box limitation that you have to deal with. It will not give you the platform experience. Like, you cannot write an app that is going to look and feel like a native app was going to feel. And finally, that in order to have an app that was going to be successful, you would have to use platform experts. So a few days ago, I got this joke from an iOS developer. I don't know if you can see what it says, but on the first column, there are a list of planets. The third one is Earth. The second column is the number of deaths. And of course, Earth is a humongous number. And then there is a boolean saying if they're using JavaScript or not. So I think as JavaScript developers, you can relate to jokes like that. So let's start from the beginning. First of all, we didn't start out to make a cross-platform application from the get-go. We already had built an iOS application, an iOS native application, that is still active on the App Store today. But people demanded an Android version yesterday. So we estimated that it would take the same amount of work that it took us to develop the iOS application, because there were little to no parts that we could reuse in the Android development. And on top of that, because as I said, Covve is a startup. We were adding features all the time, so the iOS application was running really fast, and the Android would have to cover that ground as well. So Covve is a thick, the Covve app is a thick offline first client with an elaborate multi-wasting mechanism. What that means is that we sync both with your native address book and our servers and Gmail and another billion things. Lots and lots of business logic exists on the client to sync with the server and other sources. And building in two platforms meant that those business requirements had to be implemented twice, bugs had to be resolved twice, and everything else. So for Covve, the app is just the tip of the iceberg. We have tens of different services running in the cloud that gather and clean and fix all the data that the app serves to our users. And Covve is a whole ecosystem, and we wanted the Covve app to be a coupled part of the rest of the Covve ecosystem. Now, given the task of building an app to an iOS developer or to a team of iOS developers and to Android developers that haven't built the rest of the system, first might seem like a good idea, but afterwards you see that domain knowledge is really, really useful, and it's not as easily acquired as programming skills. So building the app in-house with existing developers that had worked on both the backend and the web app that was pre-existing gave a different perspective and velocity to the whole project, maximizing the skill set, reuse, and knowledge sharing and ownership. Because of that deeper knowledge, the multi-platform app server sync, that's the whole concept of syncing your contacts with our servers, is now 17 times faster than it was in the native app, mainly because of the people writing it using the domain knowledge from the rest of the Covve. So we wanted Covve to have a distinct look. We didn't want to build an app like a Compass or something like that that would look like iOS on iOS and like Android on Android. We wanted our UX to be identical. We wanted the animations to be the same. We wanted the transitions to be the same. We wanted our error handling to be the same. So instead of building two different applications and one in iOS and one in Android and try to make them look and feel the same, so double the work, we decided it would be a much better approach to do this once and do it right. So finally, after evaluating all the cross-platform offerings at the time, we decided to go with Ionic as our multi-platform framework. So let's go back 2 years or so. 2 years ago, React Native was just a concept. Probably not even that. I think it started March 2015 or something like that as a concept inside Facebook. NativeScript was in early alpha. NativeScript is the offering from Telerik, another company very similar to React Native, but it was in early alpha. Xamarin is a cross-platform application backed by Microsoft that uses C#. And for us, with a C# background, that was a very compelling option, but had various issues specific to our case, mainly contact manipulation. And code sharing was at best 50%, which was not fitting all our bills. The part about using it C#, as I said, was very compelling, but after doing an extensive research on it, we decided not to go with it. Ionic at the time was a more mature option. Nothing was nothing too high-tech at the time. Good old battle-tested Cordova as the lower layer, plus great web UI. Performance was acceptable, but not great at the time. Code sharing was above 95%, so that was something that we really liked. And we liked the full web concept much better than different proprietary approaches that you didn't know that if they were going to be around the next year or so. The fact that it used Angular at the time was our favorite framework, was also something that sealed the deal. So we had to believe in the future to make that choice. We wanted to believe that everything was going to get better, faster, easier. We delved into that when we made an educated choice that since Angular 2 was coming in the game, we knew about Service Worker, that we're going to be a part of Safari at some point as well. Web components used by libraries like Polymer were performing great. Browser support was getting better and better with native web APIs. And an early concept of what is today known as PWAs, Progressive Web Apps, was brewing at the time. So the future looked promising, and we placed our chips on it. So let's talk about how Ionic works today. And when I say today, I mean yesteryear, because it's going to be changing really fast. Like in the next few days, we're going to be releasing version 4, which is a total rewrite of both the library and their concept, but more on that later. So Ionic is a complete tool set. Everything works out of the box, so you don't have to configure your webpack, you don't have to deal with Angular or things like that. You just use their CLI, which is a wrapper for the Cordova CLI and Angular CLI, so it abstracts a lot of things for you. And it has native wrappers, which are used to bring the Cordova plugins to the future, instead of using callbacks and things like that for interacting with native plugins. You now use async await and observables. And also Ionic is a framework, so it's a framework wrapper for Angular at the moment. It gives you a platform specific SaaS, so when you create a button, and an HTML button, depending on the platform, it will style it so it will look exactly the same as native. And in most cases, even the animations, the transitions, everything are the same, so you cannot tell them apart from native if that's what you want to do. In our case, it wasn't. Cordova, which is the bottom layer, which where your app is bundled and sent to the App Store inside a Cordova container. Cordova, although very powerful, is probably the bad kid of the block. It has a huge open source ecosystem, and everything is a module, which sounds great in concept, but in reality, this leads to bad versioning, incompatibilities, unmaintained packages, etc. So most of our setbacks were had to do with Cordova, not Angular and Ionic themselves. So as I said in the beginning, all of these are about to change in the next few days. Ionic is releasing version 4, which is going to be stop being a framework, and it's going to be framework agnostic, so you can use it with your React, your Vue.js, Angular, or whatever you like. It's going to be just a set of web components, which are performing much better than Angular components, so performance is going to be better out of the box. And Cordova is going to be phased out by a similar offering by the same team called Capacitor, which gives you the opportunity to write native code directly and not with all the hassle that Cordova and Apache have thought of including plugins and everything. You're just going to be opening Xcode and writing some code. You're going to be opening your Android Studio and write some code there. And that's going to be making things much easier than struggling to fit version with version of plugins and things like that. And also, Capacitor has now their offering as well. It's going to give us access to using native UI components. So if you want to make a list in your app, an HTML, that's fine. If you want to make it the native version of that, that's going to be fine as well. So you can use both in your app, so you can hit that sweet spot of performance and look and development speed. So over to Valadis.
Thanks. Okay. So now we're going to talk about some technologies, libraries, tools. Without, we couldn't survive making an XP app. First of all, TypeScript. TypeScript, as you all know, is a strongly typed set of JavaScript. And it was really an ideal fit for us, especially for programmers such like me, who had a C# background, or like programmers with a C++ or Java background. It makes you feel at home. You have all the object-oriented goodies you are used to, like polymorphism, inheritance, private public members, classes. It feels like home. In a loosely typed word like you have in JavaScript, and as Mike said, we have a thin client with a lot of business logic and a big team. It's getting harder and harder to maintain a project in a loosely typed word like JavaScript if you don't apply really strict rules in your team when you code and commit. So basically what TypeScript provides is a linter on steroids, some rules that the team has to follow. And first of all, you got type safety, okay? So you declare the type of the variables and objects you are going to use. And you also got IntelliSense, so when I write, the TypeScript will propose the thing I'm thinking by just clicking the first letter. And but for me, the most important thing TypeScript provides is helping you write clean code that expresses the developer's intention. And it makes code more readable, especially for developers like me who come from a C# background and were not like a JavaScript ninja or anything. So the second and harder to explain will be RxJS. The definition, I was in a meetup here, you guys presented it. Basically, it's a library for reactive programming using observables. And what RxJS does is treats all data as a stream, like you see. So observable is a set of data over time. So the arrow is time, and the little balls, like we call it, balakia in Greek, is the values over time. So what is powerful with balakia is the operators, because they are sets of values, and the power in those sets of values is that you have lots of operators you can apply. An example of an operator is a map operator, as you can see. So we have a set of values over time, and the map operator takes a value from the stream and returns 10 times that value. So that's the most simple operator I can find, but you get a lot of operators. And basically, you have a stream, then you end up with another stream, then you apply another operator, you end up with another stream, and so you get a lot of streams, one after another, and it's like a funnel-like approach. You get a lot of funnels, and it reminded me of like link queuing C# or loaders in JavaScript. It's like you can think of it as loaders for events. And it was a perfect match for us because that funnel-like approach helped us, of course, in the front-end scenarios when the user entered a lot of data, but also in our thick kind of back-end business logic, where, for example, in our sync scenarios, we get the user's contacts from the native address book for the iPhone, that's the iPhone or the Android address book, get it to the app, sync it to the server, make it better, and get them back. So this funnel-like approach was a really good match for us. Basically, we don't have in our code many fences. We can handle the race conditions better. It's a high-level approach, a more expressive approach. And basically, it's one of the top ways you have in JavaScript to handle asynchrony, especially if you compare it like to callbacks and the hell you get from callbacks, or promises. That's a debate, but observables have some better parts against promises. there are a stream of multiple events. In promises, you only get a single output, and in promises, you can't cancel the promise. Here, people, the observers, subscribe to the observable. They hear those streams of values, and they can unsubscribe when some business criteria are met. The operators are really like your, are really a huge weapon. You have really many operators, a really good documentation with example like that, and they help you like for many, many use cases. So, immutability. When you have a large application, like in a reactive or a functional world mainly, with a lot of objects that mutate and people share these objects, it can be really, it can get really complex. So let's check out this diagram. Here we have, it's basically how we organize state and behavior in our objects. We can have mutable objects or immutable and unshared objects and shared. So if you have a mutable object that it's unshared that only one guy uses, it's okay, you don't have a problem. If you have an unshared object, only one that it's immutable, it's again okay. But if you are on your top right, I guess, where you have mutable and shared objects, that is where all the pain is. If you have mutable and shared objects, shared objects that many people consume, it's chaos. We have tried out, never tried at home. It's not a funny story. Mutation by definition is a side effect. It's really difficult to debug, to figure out if you have many mutable objects, who changed what. It's really hard to debug. So the only solution in this reactive world, if you have many shared objects, is to make them immutable. In a mutable world, once something is created, it's never changed. So you end up with a more reliable world and objects. And you will think, okay, I will make my shared objects immutable. What about performance? In immutability, you make copies of copies of copies of copies of copies. That's why it's so reliable. But you have to think about performance. If we would do a framework, probably it wouldn't be that performant. But thankfully, there are many smart guys who have made advanced data structures that are utilized in frameworks such as ImmutableJS, the one that Facebook uses. So if you want immutability in JS, you can use a framework like ImmutableJS, and it provides reliability, acceptable performance, and a lot of data structures which you can use, like immutable maps, all the mutable data structures, you can have it in the immutable world also. Of course, it's not necessary to use immutability everywhere. We have parts of our system, of our XP app, that it's only a mutable object. Not many people touch it, so it's okay to be mutable. You have to decide where to use mutability. And one of the issues we discovered is that TypeScript doesn't play well with mutability, and you got to try a bit to fix it. So that TypeScript warns you if you don't pass the right type of immutable objects. Testing. Okay. In a large project with a lot of business rules and use cases and a large team, you can't survive without testing. It improves quality and speed. It makes you think about all the use cases beforehand, test all the use cases. You don't have to manually test after every change, manually again and again every time I change my code. It gives you the confidence to refactor your code. It gives you the confidence to add a new feature without being scared that I destroyed the feature of Mike. And because we chose an XP app, we were very lucky because Angular is obsessed with testing. And from what I understand, Angular is more like in testing than the native apps. So you don't have native developers don't think about, they are not test first guys usually, because many of them are used to like simple, not thick business clients. So Angular gives you a lot of choice for testing. It's not as good as C Sharp or Java. You don't have like the out of the box stuff, but you have a lot of choices like Jasmine, Karma, Wallaby. You have a lot of choices to play with. And we use testing everywhere. We even use testing to battle test frameworks and practices. What I mean is, for example, for ArcGIS and ImmutableJS that I mentioned, we have lots of learning tests because we didn't know these frameworks. And so we created learning tests, and the tests run every time and verify that we understand correctly ImmutableJS and ArcGIS. And we have more than 2,000 tests. And as you see from the famous pyramid over there, you got to have a lot of unit tests that test the every unit of work, that every unit of work, like every class, every function, does what it's supposed to do. We have some integration tests that guarantee that the different unit of works work well together and communicate as they should. And you should have less end-to-end tests. The end-to-end tests are the most expensive, and the unit tests should run in an automated platform, and they should always run fast. So, has anyone developed a native app, like installed an app in a native? No? if you want to debug or deploy a native app in the app itself, it can be a problem. It's like it's time wasting. And that applies for emulators too. So since we are writing an Angular SPA, basically, you can, in the scenarios you don't want to play like with the contacts or something that the mobile has, like or front-end scenarios or maybe on our server sync that has nothing to do partly with native, you can play, you don't have to run it in the app or on an emulator, and you just play with Chrome like a web developer usually does. And Chrome DevTools are your best ally here. You can develop in Chrome, debug in Chrome, profile in Chrome to improve your performance. It's basically our best friend. And we test in the app only if we have to. I test in the app if I cannot test in Chrome first, because if I can't test in Chrome, it saves me a lot of time and I'd go to run it in the browser. So, browser. Your app renders on a web view. That's basically a view that displays a web page, kind of a wrapper that inside HTML and JavaScript corresponding technologies are executed. So there you have all the problems you have in a browser, all the limitations you have in a browser. And what do you have? You have to worry about DOM. You have to keep the DOM small. And for us, it was a really big problem rendering huge list of contacts. If you have huge list of contacts, it's a problem. And one of the techniques used to solve that problem is, for example, virtual scroll. Do we know JS fatigue or framework fatigue? No?
Yeah.
When you start to make something in JavaScript or probably in other technologies, you start and you read and you have to figure out how am I going to do that? And you're like, choices everywhere. Should I choose that technology? Okay, I choose the first technology. Now, that doesn't solve my problem. I need something else. Oh, I have three other technologies over there to choose to help me solve my problem. That's a framework fatigue, more or less. And choice is good, but too much choice can be scary. You always question yourself, did I make the right choice? Maybe I should have done the other choice. And for example, we had to go when we started writing the app. I think it was in Angular and AngularJS now, and then we moved on to Angular because Angular moved on. And the problem here is we have like a kind of a framework fatigue inside, like Cordova. Things in Cordova always change. Like my previous week, I was trying to figure out. In your mobile phones, you have like the local notifications. That's the notifications you get that are produced from your own phone, not push notifications. So Cordova, of course, has a plugin that provides that functionality for Android, iPhone, and BlackBerry, and I don't know what. And that the current stable plugin doesn't solve all our use cases. So there's a new version of the plugin, and I was like, yeah, now I'm going to fix all my use cases. I downloaded, I started messing around with the new plugin, and I read the plugin. The plugin said it's a beta version. And I was like, maybe. Okay, beta, but it promised to solve a use case. It promised to implement a use case I couldn't. So I was like, okay, let's go with the beta plugin. I tried to use the beta plugin. I figured out that it had not an Ionic wrapper. Ionic promises to wrap every plugin, and basically when Ionic wraps the plugin, it wraps the Cordova plugin, the native Cordova plugins have callbacks. Ionic provides promises, resolves these callbacks in promises, so you play with promises, and then I do observable for promise and so on. And I was like, okay, callbacks, let's go for it. But you have to make a lot of scary decisions. And sometimes, or every new plugin or every new framework advertise itself like it's a new silver bullet. So it's like hard not to try if it's the best solution for you and your app, and that's what will make the difference. Hopefully, one day we'll be in a stable state and we don't have to choose any over and over again, make all these scary decisions. Cordova. Cordova is, it promises greatness. It's a great promise. Ask from me whatever you like, and I will provide it from either Android or iPhone. It does it in up to a point. It's an Apache project. Apache is a great stable organization, but it's not as fast moving, let's say, as Google or something. It's like it's moving slowly compared to other web technologies. And you have a lot of problems with Cordova, let's say challenges. One of them is, for example, I wanted to get the last calls from an Android phone. I know that if you are an Android developer, you can get the last calls you made from your phone. So I tried to figure out if Cordova provides that capability for me. It didn't. I wondered why. Then I figured out that iPhone doesn't provide this capability. So if something isn't provided by both iPhone and Android, Cordova doesn't provide it. It provides the smallest common denominator, which is not the best case. For another scenario is that our core business is contacts. So Cordova plugin has a plugin that provides the contacts, but the contacts it provides are not as detailed as we would like. Like they are missing some information. It has the basic stuff, but not everything. So in that scenario, if you are in an XP app and the plugin doesn't provide your core business data, what do you do? You have to learn, you have to make a guy learn Swift or Objective-C, and another guy learn Java, and you have to basically write your own plugin. So, and of course, you don't have any Swift or Java developer in your team, because if you did, you wouldn't be writing an XP app. Plugin incompatibilities. Plugin have a lot of incompatibilities, one with another, because they are maintained by different people. Some plugins are abandoned. And we have versioning nightmares, meaning that when you get the plugin you want, each plugin has the permission to specify with which core Cordova edition it works with. So the new notification plugin says it works with the 9 core Cordova edition. And I download another plugin, and the new plugin says I work with the 10 Cordova edition and not the 9, so that's a big problem. And if you end up looking inside the plugins, the code is not so readable, and sometimes the documentation is not the best. Sometimes it is good, sometimes it's not that good, and you have to like trial and error a lot to figure out what you have to do. That's a reactive problem. Say that you do, in a reactive world, RxJS, you do an API call in our server and you get like 400 contacts from the server in an API call. And now you have streams and every stream does something with the contacts. And at the end, like at low at the funnel, you save, you persist at the last step. What happens, especially in a mobile app, if the app drains of battery, if someone kills the app, if somebody, I don't know, steals the app, it's not as stable as a server. You have to figure out what will happen if anywhere in a process where I have data I don't want to lose, something stops. Because you have, as we said, balakia, and we're always wondering where are the balakia now if something stops. So that's only for data you don't want to lose. Maybe if you press a button in a form, you don't care. But for contacts, we care. So we have to make sure that a user never loses contacts. So there's a lot of logic, depending on their business case, how we'll won't lose the user's valuable data. There are a lot of ways to solve this, but there are extra weight, it's an extra difficulty. You can use queues, you can retry an API call. You have to make sure that if you retry something, data won't be replicated, or the user doesn't end up with 2 contacts because I make something twice not to lose data. And maybe you have to persist between the streams something, maintain your own queue. Maybe it's balaki should know its state. It's a big conversation. And of course, in this, in a reactive world, you have to use a virtual consistency in your advantage because you have many observers who do stuff all over the app or in the backend of the app that the user does not see. And there will be a window in time that the data aren't consistent across the app. But you have to make sure that even if the user kills the app and opens it, after a while, the data will be consistent. So you have to use a virtual consistency and for performance reasons also. Performance. As we said, you have to think about performance. It's never a given. You have to take care of DOM. You have to check, do I have memory leaks? You have to use data structures. As we said, even in the immutable world, we got a lot of data structures we can use. You have to use like the algorithms you learned in university. If I have to do sorting, maybe should I use this algorithm? You have to use the event loop. You have to use web workers that enable you to offload an expensive operation to a different thread. You have to wonder, is this a functionality I need in client side? Should be always available offline? Or could this functionality implemented online and by the server? So you have to debate. This could implement it also from the server. Should I do it? And of course, Chrome DevTools, as we said, is a valuable ally regarding performance also. Another challenge in our case can be what happens if you have an iOS app already deployed in production, you have made an XP Android app already deployed in production in Play Store, but now you want to replace the iPhone native app with a new XP platform app. That's tricky. Especially, you have to know that Alex over there doesn't want any user ever to re-login. If a user re-logins, you get fired. So that's a deal. So ideally, you don't have, the user won't realize anything that a migration happened. That's in the ideal world. Probably you have to like do a step or two. You have to plan ahead if you can. You have to have logic in the server, it will help you. And kind of, that's a kind of a UX a business side of things. You have to make the user worthwhile, like waiting for the migration. You have to provide him new features, you have to make a cool migration screen. You have to promise him greatness, to like maybe because he'll have to wait for a few seconds at least, best case scenario. Mike.
Okay, so let's watch a very short video of comparing two iPhones running our app side by side. One is native, the other is cross-platform. So keep in mind that our iOS version of the cross-platform app is still in beta because we haven't released it. But keep in mind that. Let's try and play that. I'll make sure it's going to play. I'm going to try for full screen. Okay. So it's a really basic scenario. We're just going to watch the app side by side. I'm just going to play. Okay, so that's what Covve looks like. One is, as I said, one is the cross-platform one, the other one is native. I'll be honest, I can hardly distinguish between the two. If some of you can, then great, which one is which. But the thing is that you can get a lot of positive things out of cross-platform development. And if you're willing to go down the road, you can see that you can get really close to having the native experience with both platforms. And as I said, this is the better version. If you compare it with the Android one, we're going to smoke it. It's going to be better than the Android one. Okay. So I'm just going to close this. Okay, so where are things today in the whole framework of things? As I said, we started about 2 years ago with that big idea. Things are a lot different today than they were when we started our quest. It's very clear that big companies are betting on cross-platform apps being a big part of the future. For instance, a very big app, Microsoft Flow, is written using Ionic, such as we're using. React Native has the lead in hybrid app development for various reasons, but that might not be the case in the near future. Airbnb app is written using it. Xamarin is now owned by Microsoft with whatever that means. Some might like it, some might not. Cordova is picking up the slack. They're moving at a higher pace. Unity is considered to be the top offering for cross-platform development for games. And as I said earlier, Ionic is changing towards a model that we only hoped it would go towards. Using native web technologies like web components and browser APIs, reaching a performance level that is second to none. We actually have already started our migration to the newest version, and it looks really great. PWAs are becoming a thing. Allowing for faster iterations and better all-around experience. You probably use Twitter Lite. Twitter Lite is a PWA. Volatility is reducing week by week. Things are getting more stable. And standards are taking over. So to finalize, did we make the right choice now that we went through all this trip? I would say we did. You can see there everything is checked, no crosses, so we did. To be honest, we adopted really early in the game. That was something we knew at the time, but we decided to make a bet for that. We got a lot of negativity about our decision early on when discussing it with other groups, which really brought us down in the beginning. At certain points, we questioned ourselves when hitting a few pain points. But ultimately, we're now certain that we made the right decision. It was a bumpy ride. But we're very happy with the results. We have changed a lot of people's minds about what's possible in this space. Our security auditors actually did not believe that we had zero findings, security findings in our app. They were like, oh, you have a cross-platform app? Okay, I'm going to tell you you're going to fail right away. But we didn't. And we have also given back a lot to the community to get here. So we did a lot of pull requests, we helped a lot of projects, so that's a plus as well. And, finally, it has helped us achieve our goals. We came out stronger as a team. We believe it gives us, it now gives us a competitive advantage, and we have a lot to look forward to. So, is it for you though? I don't know. The answer is it depends. So, as Marmite is like 50% of the people love it, 50% hate it. It's probably something like that. It's probably not an ideal solution for everyone, but if your app fits a certain pattern, and we can discuss later about what that pattern is, but generally if it has a lot of business logic, if it has web content, if it has a unique UX, and you're willing to adapt, and you're not Facebook, so a huge company that has limitless resources, or you're not building a game, if you use Unity, then give it a try. That's all. Thank you.